to the new Spirit FM Music. Ministry.
Jesus says in John chapter 14, 16, He will never leave us. He will never leave us. Deuteronomy 31, 6. He will never leave you or forsake you. Deuteronomy 31, 8. Do not be afraid.
WAFG LP, Pompano Beach, Spirit FM.
And I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, no matter what my circumstances or situations are.
Let my words be true.
Is In the Word Live, the conversational Bible study with Pastor Ken Carrigan, pastor of Calvary Chapel, Cornerstone Church.
Speak over the fear. God, your voice is the only thing.
Now, tonight's host, Pastor Ron Burr.
And good evening. Hey, welcome to In the Word Live here on Spirit FM Radio, a ministry of Calvary Chapel, Pompano Beach. So glad to be here with you tonight. I am Pastor Ron, one of the associate pastors at Calvary Chapel, Pompano Beach. I believe we have a very special program in store for you tonight. I'm glad you're here with us. Just a little bit about our radio station and our church. We do meet at 132 Southeast 11th Avenue in Pompano Beach. We meet at 10 o'clock on Sunday mornings. We are Calvary Chapel, Pompano Beach. How do you find us? Easiest way to find us is with our website, which is calvarypb.com. That's calvarypb.com. On that website, you'll find out all about our church. Lots of things on there, our staff, what we believe, where we're located, and we just would invite you to go there and check us out. If you'd like to watch live video from our radio station tonight, you can do that also by going to our church website, which is calvarypb.com. Up in the upper right-hand corner, there is a tab that's called Media Ministry. Click on that tab, and it'll take you right to live video here in the studio. And you can watch and listen right from our beautiful studio here in Pompano Beach. We are a 100% listener-supported radio station, and if you would like to help keep radio, Christian radio on the air, Spirit FM radio, you can go to our church website, and on the upper right-hand corner, again, is the donate button, and you can securely and safely help support our radio station, and we would really appreciate that. I believe we have just a wonderful program for you tonight. We kind of touched on this program a little bit last week, Pastor Bill, and I'm a little bit not used to seeing you all the way over there. That's a little bit strange, you know? The next step out is outside for you, you know?
It's the third time you threatened that.
I know. Yeah. Well, you've been, you know, a little bit harsh to me tonight, you know?
My
feelings
my
have
heart.
Been hurt. My feelings are hurt, you know?
It's not even football season when
I know,
normally we clash.
I know, and that's usually when we clash because, you know, you are that Buffalo Bills fan and I am a Miami Dolphins fan, so we do clash a lot, you know, at least twice a year, you know, we're butting heads, you know?
Yeah.
But anyways. Yeah. It's good to have you in the studio tonight. How are you doing, Pastor Bill?
Doing very well, and we have a lot to talk about tonight. Actually have some friends of mine here with us tonight.
Would you introduce them for us tonight?
I would love to introduce them to you. This is Jason and Smitha Mathew, and what I would say is a month ago, I would say I know Jason and Smitha because if I see their faces, I know who they are, but I wouldn't say we were like close friends or anything, but I'll never say that again. We are close friends now, and we've been bonded by something that nobody would ever want to occur. No. And we talked about it a little bit last week, but Jason and Smitha got the phone call that nobody wants to get, and it was that their child was experiencing a medical emergency, and their child did not survive that medical emergency, and she passed away on Good Friday. And so Jason called me early in that process. I actually got a call from another member of the school the very night that it happened and went up to the hospital that night. I got there about 8 o'clock at night and to see from a distance, because we couldn't get too close, but to see Jason and Smitha engaged in very fervent prayer. And we ended up having, you know, lots of people in the waiting room just praying with them. And nobody knew what to expect at that point in time. And little did I know that what the next week would hold, or nor did they know what the next week would hold. And so we, as a community at Calvary Christian Academy and Calvary Chapel Fort Lauderdale and really all of the satellite campuses around and many other churches that cover South Florida, just rallied in prayer and in visitation. I think we made the hospital staff a little uncomfortable at times because the amount of people in the hallways sitting there hours and hours and hours on end, the amount of song that would break out and worship in the hallways, and I'm sure that hospital's talking about that situation. And so navigating that week with Jason and Smitha was something I've never done before. And I could tell you this, I feel a bond with them now that I feel like we've been hanging out for 20 years, quite frankly. Mm. And but something is going on with this whole situation that is an experience we're still unpacking. We keep seeing fruit come on a daily basis, salvations, recommitments, people just getting views of God they've never had before and so forth. And there's a lot to tell. So I want to introduce to everybody Jason and Smitha Mathew, parents of Selah Mathew and Karis Mathew and Rayma Mathew and Luke Mathew. The latter three were, I just saw them at the beach just absolutely having a blast in the water because Jason and I, we baptized on the last two Sundays 18 people, most of them high school students, a couple middle school age, and one adult.
One parent today.
And so, there's this incredible fruit that's coming from it. So we want to talk to Jason and Smitha today, just how this dynamic's played out, because these are people that are strong and deep in their faith, but you always kind of wonder when a real storm comes, you know, what's going to come out of you.
Yeah. I think that's really important, Pastor Bill, when you just said that, when the real storm comes up, you know, when we're in that storm battling those waves and the winds of that terrific storm, how do we handle it? You know, we talked about that this morning as I taught our testimony. You know, you can't turn your testimony on with a light switch and turn it off with a light switch. Your testimony is always there. And I would say that just by speaking to you for the last half an hour and knowing what Pastor Bill has told us, your testimony is what is shining out there right now. You know, we live in like a fishbowl. And, you know, when that goldfish is swimming around, wherever you're looking in the fishbowl, you can see the goldfish. It's wide open. And our testimony is kind of like that, that the world is looking at us. And I guarantee the world looked at you guys, whether it was in the hospital, whether it was at the funeral home, whether it was at the summit, wherever it was, the world looked at you guys, and your testimony has stood out bright and strong. Jason, tell us a little bit about where you'd like to start, because I'm not sure where you'd like to start tonight, but share with us what is on your heart tonight.
Well, first of all, this became our testimony. We didn't choose this testimony. You know, like Pastor Bill said, we got a call on that Thursday that we didn't anticipate. You know, I rushed to the hospital. On the way to the hospital, I called Smitha, who was at work at the pharmacy working. On the way to the hospital, I prayed with our pastor, Pastor Steve, talked with our small groups leader, prayed with him. One of the teachers from CCA had called me on the way there. It's not until I got the call from the CCA teacher that I realized this is serious. It's not until I got to the hospital that I saw Dr. Rachels, our CCA head, and a couple teachers. still didn't know exactly what was going on. Couple of the paramedics had come out and met me in the ER, and it was almost like they were trying to stall. They were trying to just get her history and ask me a bunch of questions. And after a while, I was like, I want to be back in the ER with Sayla. And I still didn't realize how serious it was until the paramedic told me that they were working on Sayla for the 20-minute ride from CCA to the ER. And when they reached the ER is when they got a pulse. And I had no idea it was that serious.
Right.
And right away, Smitha came in 5 minutes later. We just went into prayer mode right away. We didn't know where else to turn to. It was the only thing we knew to do. So it was automatic to turn to God.
Right.
We saw the doctors, the nurses, about 10, maybe a dozen people in the room working on her. And it didn't matter what else was going on in this world. All we had was God. All we knew to do was to pray in that moment. And it started a week-long journey being in the ER. And we did not stop praying. We did not stop worshiping. We didn't stop declaring God's word over Sayla's life. It was the only thing we knew to do.
So, Smitha, tell us a little bit about what you're going through at this point. You've gotten a call from Jason. You're at work.
Yeah, I'm in the middle of work, and everybody knows not to call me because it's very busy, usually between that 4 and 7 time when all the families are coming in to pick up their prescriptions. And I see a phone call from my husband, and I pick up the phone real quick, and I said, "Hey, what's up? I'm at work." And then that's when he tells me that Sayla's been taken by ambulance. And of course, I got scared.
Sure.
And thank you to the Walgreens crew that was able to help me shut down the pharmacy, and the school tried to call me as well to, you know, offer me a ride to the hospital. The Lord gave me the strength to be able to drive myself there.
Okay.
And just crying on the way, you know, just protect her, Lord. And there's no time at that time to flip through the Bible,
right,
to remember those verses. It's only the verses that you memorized,
right,
that come to your mind. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. And those were verses, many psalms we have memorized with the kids.
Right.
And especially during COVID time, Jason had encouraged us to memorize Psalm 91. And so those were the words that we were, you know, able to recite.
Right.
And comfort us during that time. And, you know, it's, I guess, before you want to be prepared before the hurricane. Of course, the Lord is gracious to allow us to learn a lot during the hurricane, but, you know, you want to be ready before the hurricane.
Right.
And that's something that Jason had said that I think is so impactful. He said to our high school students, he says, "It's not that I went and got faith when this happened to help me through it. I was brought up in a heritage of faith, and I've had the word poured into me, you know, from my parents and so forth, and we were doing that with our children." So in other words, they already had established their identity in Christ when the storm came. And because they were so rooted in it, it was able to serve them in tremendous ways of comfort and trust, because 8 days of prayers that none of them were asking for the outcome that you got, there was a different outcome came. And so that's another thing that had to be wrestled with. Was because we had a lot of people in our communities convinced that with all the prayer going out, God's certainly going to get her out of that bed. And so there came a time where it goes, no, God's got something different here. And then it became, you know, just as Jason would be our communication voice of here's what's going on, he would stun us just with the poise that he had, the trust in God, the call to continue in faithful prayer for various things. And he really was trying to hold the community up and say, you know, I still believe in worship and praise. And I think that's why so many wonderful things are coming from this now.
So Jason, you're in the hospital. Smitha, you're in the hospital. Were you there by yourself at this point when Selah first got to the hospital? Did you have other family members there, or did other people from the church come in?
Yeah, we had a lot of people.
A lot of people.
Right at the beginning, like I said, I remember walking into the ER. Dr. Rachels was there. There was another teacher there. The teacher that rode in the ambulance was there. Smitha came a few minutes later. But yeah, our family started arriving probably within an hour.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you're there, and are you back in the ER room now?
Yep.
With Selah?
Mm-hmm.
And
yes.
You're praying over her.
Yeah.
And
watching all these doctors and nurses and just working on her. You could tell she wasn't responsive. When the doctor first came out, she said they had a pulse. Her lungs weren't responding to the treatment that they were giving her. So she was saying they were repeating the doses. Everything was high dose, trying to get the lungs to respond. That was tough to hear.
Yeah. That was tough to hear.
Yeah.
So at that point, Smitha, were you still going to the Psalms and going in prayer at that point?
When I walked in, I automatically wanted to panic because I'm a mom. Mm-hmm.
Sure.
And it's the worst fear coming true.
Right.
My husband grabs my hand and said, this is not the time to panic. It's time to pray. Mm-hmm. And that just help me to say, okay.
Come to pray.
That's right.
Okay.
You wonder how many wives, Jason, would choose to listen to that rather than panic. So that's what we're, when I say you had faith sown into you and you were authentic about that faith throughout your lives, now part of the testimony that we see is we never saw the panic. We saw the prayer. We saw the first time I saw you, I think you were on the floor praying. And I keep saying how, I don't know how your arm didn't get tired, because every time I looked at Jason, his arm was extended towards the room, you know, praying as all the doctors were in there and so forth. There's so many stories about this week, you know, and certainly after the week. And just what's staying with you guys right now as like impactful about that week as far as family, community, you know, what was helping you guys or what was hindering you guys?
Yeah, I think the first surprise for me, they worked on Selah for a while in the ER. They were able to stabilize her as best they could at one point, and that's when they decided to transfer her to the seventh floor, which is the PICU, the pediatric ICU. They continued to work on her for a while up in PICU. It was maybe at least an hour and a half afterwards that we were able to go in, where they had stabilized her enough where we could actually go into her room and see her, got a quick update from the nurse on what was going on. And then I remember walking out into the hallway and just being stunned that there were at least 40 people outside. It was CCA community. It was our church community, Calvary Chapel Fort Lauderdale. Mm. We attend Calvary Chapel Parkland. It was my mom's church, so the Indian community.
A lot of support
right
around
from
you.
The beginning.
A lot of support all around you.
Stunned me that we had that much support,
yeah.
And it just didn't stop. The 8 days that we were there,
it grew,
and we never felt alone. We knew the presence of God was with us, but we knew the body of Christ was with us, and that was an experience in itself.
Did you stay at the hospital most of the time for that week? That 8 days, were you there all the time?
Yeah, so I had made a point to just go home. I would normally go home, like, around, I think that first day I didn't go leave till probably 5 in the morning. Somebody from our church, James from Calvary Chapel Parkland, had said he was going to open up the church every morning at 5:30 in the morning during our 21 days of fasting and prayer leading up to Easter. So I left the hospital around 5 in the morning that next morning, and I knew I just wanted to be home when the kids woke up, just to explain to them what was going on. And on the way home, I was like, well, the kids aren't up yet. Let me stop by the church and pray, because I knew James was going to open up the church at 5:30 in the morning. So I went there. There was probably, I think, 3 people there that morning, and I just went to the altar and I prayed maybe for 5 minutes, but and then I went home just to be with the kids that morning, and then went back to the hospital. So I made it a point every night to, I probably left like around 11 p.m. every night, went home, took a shower, and came right back. Smitha was there, I think, for 4 or 5 days straight, did not leave. You didn't leave till probably Monday or Tuesday just to go home and take.
Did they let you stay in the?
Yes. They were so gracious.
Intensive care room at that point.
Yeah.
Yeah. The nurses were so compassionate towards her.
And they were
and towards us. Yeah. Like, first day was just all the time somebody would come and give you a hug.
Yeah.
Mm. And I've just never experienced so much compassion. And they deal with so much hard situations.
Difficult situations.
And I've exchanged some phone numbers with some of the nurses there. And even now, she says, you know, we try not to get too close to the patients because it's so difficult for them to,
every day
having to experience these hard situations. Right. Yeah, but she said, it was too difficult to stay away from you guys.
Yeah.
It was too difficult. And they were just so kind to us.
Yeah. Well, that's your testimony just showing through. You see, that's what everybody saw right there in the beginning. They saw you guys praying. They saw you guys on your knees. They saw a support around you from the church and your family. And that's just that wonderful testimony, too. Wouldn't you agree to that, Pastor Bill?
Absolutely. And just seeing them over the course of the week in the room, we did a whole lot of praying, a whole lot of singing, scripture reading, but what just fed into me was watching you guys grieve, just watching you believe, and then just how you handled it hour by hour. And I think Smith and I, there were several God moments that I experienced. I think you guys have all these God moments, because, you know, Jason, you've said you always felt God's presence there. You always felt His presence there. And as I was doing my very best to ask the Lord just to share your guys' hearts with me, that I could grieve with you and weep with you and all of that, I saw in Smitha the morning, I believe it was the morning they took her off the life support, I saw her bury her head on the side of the bed and weeping and praying. And all I could picture was the angel telling Mary that the child she's going to bear is going to pierce her soul.
Mm.
And I'm looking at a mom with a pierced soul.
Right.
And what surprised me was when Smitha lifted up her head, she looked at me. And so I was kind of like in that thought, and I just
went. You said it was, isn't it hard to be a Mary?
Yeah, I told her, I said, your soul's being pierced by your child the way Mary's was, and it's not easy being a Mary. Mm-hmm. And then you said to me what?
My middle name is Mary.
Oh, wow. Wow.
Yeah, it's the name that I received when I was baptized as a child at church. But
Yeah. And then we had a Friday night viewing.
Let's save that, because I want to go into after the hospital, after Good Friday. I'd have to go in that after a break, because I'm going to take a break here in just a second, and we'll move into that portion of your testimony. I'll just share with you before we go on break. And somebody asked me this just on Friday night of last week. We were having dinner with some friends, and they said, they're Christian people, and we were talking, and they said, have you ever heard God speak to you? I said, well, I have. When my wife was 7 months pregnant many, many years ago, we lost our little boy, Kyle Ryan, and he was stillborn. Mm-hmm. And I had been at the hospital all day with her, and she was still in the hospital. Our son was home with his grandmother, and it was late at night. I got into bed, and about 3 o'clock in the morning, the phone rang. I said, oh, now what? Well, it was the alarm company from the business that I work for, the burglar alarm, and I was first on the call out list. So I had to get up and run out and go let the police into the building. And there was nobody there, so I drove home. And when I was pulling the car into the driveway, into the garage, I was listening to Christian radio, and I don't know who the artist was. I don't know what the song was. Never heard it again. But there was words that came on the radio: God has a reason and a purpose. Mm-hmm. And that stuck with me for the rest of my life. And I know that was just God speaking to me, saying, this is a difficult time you're going through right now. It was hard. It was hard for my wife. Harder for my wife than it was for me. And I will tell you that I understand. And I know that because she struggled with that for a long time. But the Lord gave us a beautiful daughter later on. But the Lord spoke to me at that time. And I'm sure the Lord has spoken to you guys so often throughout this. And when we come back from break, I want you to tell us, you took sail off the life support. That's where I'd kind of like you to start when we come back for our listening audience, and share with us as we go through the rest of the time up until really today. I'd like you to share that. So if listening to audience, and we just hang in there. We're going to be back in just a second, and don't go away.
Precious fountain that saves from sin. I am so glad I have entered in. There Jesus saves me and keeps me clean. Glory to His name. I sing it, glory to His name. Glory.
Hi, this is Arnie. Thanks for listening to Spirit FM Radio.
He is more than you could ever need. He's more than the eye could see. I don't deserve His love, but He's always been there for me. You see, Jesus met me when I was at my lowest. And if you don't know Jesus, know this. He is the greatest example of generosity this world of greed has ever seen. And when Jesus hit the scene, He changed the scenery and met diversity with serenity. If you're looking for peace, He offers plenty. Jesus was and Jesus will forever be King. And when the angels sing, they sing of the grace that was displayed for sinners like me. I can't explain Him and I can't describe Him. And if I could, He wouldn't be Jesus, because you can't explain eternity and you can't comprehend the galaxies. But it was the loving hands of Jesus who spun them into existence and created man, knowing He would go to the cross to pay our sentence. There was a certificate of judgment with a period after the sentence, and we were sentenced to death long before He said, it is finished. He is a father to the orphan, a shelter for the homeless, a hiding place for the abused, and an anchor for our storms.
You're listening to Spirit FM. Isaiah 40:31. But they who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not grow faint. It's in there, in the Word. In the Word Live continues.
And we're back. Hey, thanks for staying with us. We have a great program here tonight. We're so blessed that Jason Smitha are here with us tonight, and I'm just so glad you're here to share your testimony about what's going on in your life and being able to share with our listeners. Thank you, Pastor Bill, for setting this up and bringing them in tonight. You know, we are Spirit FM Radio. We're on Sunday nights at 6 o'clock and Wednesday nights at 7 for In the Word Live, live conversational Bible study, and we just invite you to tune in and listen as we dig deep into the Scriptures. So I love Matthew 5:16, and I shared this with the folks this morning. This is, in the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your Heavenly Father. And I kind of, as we've been sitting here talking tonight, that verse just jumps out at me that that's what you guys are doing. You know, the whole world can see how you've handled this storm that you've gone through. So, Pastor Bill, tell us a little bit about where you were now at this point. It's Good Friday, and you guys had made the determination to take Selah off the breathing device. Was that your decision to do that, or was it the doctor's advice? Or tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, so Thursday night, they had scheduled a second brain assessment to assess her brain activity at 4 p.m. on Thursday. And they had told us if the results came back and confirmed the first one, which was done 24 hours before on Wednesday, she would be declared brain dead. And they said they would keep her on the ventilator for maybe a few more, you know, hours if we had family that wanted to come in town to see her. And I had, from the very beginning, realized that medicine and the doctors had their own limitations. From the very beginning, God had put it on my heart that He knit Selah together, and I didn't want the doctors to have the final say. As parents, we didn't knit her together. I didn't want to have the final say either. I wanted God to have the final say. So when the doctor said the second brain assessment matched the first one, I just asked him, I was like, can we have till 7:30 the next morning? And I wanted to give her over to God, knowing that we had done everything that we could do, the doctors had done everything that they could do, and I just wanted to have that one last night to just lay her before God and say, God, we've done everything we could do. She is totally in your hands. We lay her at your altar, and you have the final say. And we would like to have her back. We continue to believe for that. But we were comfortable knowing that we laid her at God's feet and He would have the final say. So we asked for that additional night, and the doctor graciously gave that to us. I told Pastor Bill this, my plan was to just go home like I did every night, take a shower, come back, and rest. We were just going to rest, knowing that she was in God's hands and He would have the final say the next morning.
Pastor Bill, had you been at the hospital at that time?
Yeah, I was there. Jason asked me to come up around the time of the second test. And so I was there Thursday, and then he asked me to come back early in the morning when we thought she'd be taken off life support around 7:30 in the morning or so. And so I got there around 7 to find that Jason and Smitha were sleeping. And as Jason said, they were going to get a good night's sleep, and that's a testimony in and of itself. And so about 8 o'clock, I think it was, Jason texted me to come in the room. And I prepared myself. In fact, I was talking with Pastor Steve. I said, you're about to get baptized by fire as a pastor, because this is not going to be an easy morning. You know, this is going to be a very difficult thing. And I'm a crier, man, you know. So so I was just ready to, and I cried all week, and I was ready to cry some more. And And I we go into the room, and I don't think this is exaggerating at all. First of all, the doctor waited until noon to come in. And from 8 o'clock to noon, I don't think there was a 10-second span where there wasn't prayer or singing or scripture reading. And a lot of times, all three were going on at once, or two of the three were going on at once. And there was a remarkable sense. I'll just say it this way. Everybody was kind of saying their goodbyes, and I saw Jason and Smitha kind of look at each other and say, okay, let's get the doctor. You know, we're ready. And they actually waited for, I think it was your mother to be ready.
Yeah. Mom had to come in. Yep. Yeah. And my dad, just to be able to spend a little time with her siblings.
Yeah. And I think, if I remember this right, you guys were asked, like, are you ready? And you said, when my mom's ready, then we'll be ready. And I just thought that was remarkable. But just that state of acceptance and trust and everything else, and so it's just amazing that it was on Good Friday. And as I told them, Sailor's in very good company about people that pass away on Good Friday. You know, very good company.
So you made a decision, and around noon it was they disconnected the breathing machine. Is that what they did? Okay. And so tell us what happened at that point. Did you head on home? Did you hang out there with the people at the church? What happened, Jason, at that point?
Yeah, actually, Pastor Bill reminded me of this. Right after it happened, I held on to Smitha, and I kept on telling her that God is faithful. I reminded her that every single promise that we claimed all week long, every single scripture that we proclaimed all week long, was still true in that very second. God didn't change. His word didn't change. And I kept on saying, God is faithful. And
she kept nodding her head yes. Yeah. I saw you nodding yes. Yeah.
We didn't, we had constant worship music going on. Mm-hmm. And that didn't change. We left it on. Because God was
all
still
week
God.
Long, we were covered with prayer.
Yeah.
From CCA, from Calvary Fort Lauderdale, Calvary Parkland, our Indian churches, and churches
and other people
all around,
the
world
that you didn't even know were praying.
All
right.
around the world.
Because right. there were people at our church praying, too.
Yeah, there was that's part of
the testimony. That was just such a truly miraculous thing that I know that God cares about this little girl, but why does the world care about this little girl?
Yeah, and it wasn't as if people were just saying, oh, we're praying for you. It was literally guys my age and older just calling me and just saying they had such a burden to wake up at 1 o'clock in the morning and start praying.
And start praying. Wow.
And it was people that we've never met, people that have never met our family, people in other states. It was truly remarkable.
So, Pastor Bill, tell us a little bit about the memorial service.
One final thought on that, because, you know, I do a lot of marriage counseling, and as I look at the husband and the wife and the relationship, I'm going to keep in my mind the standard that you guys set in that hospital room of, you know, you embracing your wife at that critical moment of saying goodbye to your daughter, and then at the hardest moment of your life, reassuring your wife about God, his faithfulness. Nothing changed about God. All the promises are still true and all of that. And that Smitha was somebody who could receive that and agree with that. And as I do premarital counseling and I look at couples that are going to become husband and wife, you know, I'm going to share that and say, are you becoming people who can respond like that? Because that was one of the best husband-wife moments I've ever seen in my life. So that was an incredible standard. Very high bar you set, but incredible standard. So the following Friday, we did a viewing attended by about 2,000 people in the sanctuary. And Jason asked me to speak last. And it's like, okay, so what am I, third or fourth? Well, at this event, I was like 20th. And if you think about sitting through 20 eulogies, you would think, I don't want to be there. but nobody wanted to leave. It was absolutely amazing time. And I think about four or five of those guys were pastors. Mm-hmm. And so I was the last pastor to speak. Now, you know how that's going to go, right? It's like I sat there with my notes and pastor one speaks. I'm like, okay, he said that. Pastor two. So then I was like, psh, that's gone. Okay. Which turned out to be a blessing because I just spoke to the family. Mm. And I had various verses come to mind about the children and Jesus saying, everybody that does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and my sister. And I asked them to turn around and look at the 2,000 people behind them and said, these are all your brothers and sisters now. Your family is huge. And I reminded Selah of the Mary moment that we had in the hospital room, but now Mary Magdalene was coming to my mind instead of Mother Mary. And I was thinking of her panic and her just the frenzy she was in when the tomb was empty and she didn't know where the body of Jesus was and nothing. She didn't know up from down, left from right. She was just, and what calmed her down was when Jesus simply said her name. He said, Mary. And everything became peaceful and everything got restored. And so I said, that's the Mary I'm seeing now in you. Is as the days, weeks, months go on, I think you're going to hear that voice in your ear to say, Mary, your baptized name, right? Mary. Mm-hmm. And that voice of Christ will give you that peace. And we have stories of how God, you know, something happens and then somebody way off on the side goes, oh my gosh, that just ministered to me so much. And one of them was his sister at the memorial, because before Selah passed away, she had said to her brother Jason here, you remind me of King David, the way you're praying. You know, his son was dying for 7 days and you were praying. And she meant it as a compliment to him. But Jason looked at her and said, I don't like how that story ends, and walked away. Well, she shared with me at the memorial, at the viewing, she said, when Jason said that to me, my heart was racing in my chest. I thought I was going to have a heart attack. I'm like, how could I have said that to my brother? I didn't think it through. And, you know, will he talk to me anymore? And she was very distraught by that. Mm. And she said, but at the viewing, when I said it and it came full circle, this was after they had embraced. And she said, I think there's just complete peace, you know, between them now and all of that. And that happened with Jason on Saturday night or Saturday afternoon at the graveside.
Well, I want you to talk a little bit about the graveside. Because I know what happened there, but I don't think all our listeners know. So you've had the memorial service at the church. You went to the graveside the same day?
Yes. Yeah. Right, so Friday night we had a viewing. Saturday we had the memorial service, and then we drove to the graveside.
And so, Smitha, how are you doing at this time? Are you hanging on to your husband? And
yeah. I mean, always throughout this journey, all I could remember is the character of God has not changed. Yeah. He's still good. He's still loving. Yeah. He's still faithful. And he's going to be able to help me see that more clearly every day.
Yeah.
And he didn't wait too long. I know. I think one of the biggest things is I know that my daughter didn't suffer. He was so kind. And, you know, my children always remind me, Mom, she doesn't have any more allergies. Mm-hmm. She's dancing with the Lord.
She's a dancer.
Yes.
Right, I remember you said that.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
In fact, I actually made reference to that in my teaching this morning, that Selah was in heaven this morning, and she was probably dancing, rejoicing, because I knew she was a dancer. And so that can give you that peace to know that your daughter is experiencing that. And that other piece is that one day we're all going to be there to experience it and just be with her.
Yes.
We're all going to be together.
Yes.
I was talking to a guy at an event last night we went to, and I didn't really know he was a believer, but after talking to him for a few minutes, I found out he was a believer, and we got to sharing a little bit, and I said, wow, we spent about 20 years in the pool business together. I'm a pool contractor. Mm-hmm. And we're going to spend eternity together. And he looked at me and said, wow, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
I said, isn't that amazing? Mm-hmm. And you think about, you know, And I think what I think about is those people that we minister to and witness to, and we see people come to know the Lord, and maybe they go to heaven before we get there, or maybe we're up there and they get there. Can you imagine? They're just going to come up and say, thank you for sharing the love of Jesus with me. And I think that's going to happen for you guys.
Absolutely.
I really do believe that, your witness and your testimony through all this has been so strong that people are just going to say, thank you. Mm-hmm. I came to know Jesus because of Selah.
Yeah, and as, again, just sharing about, again, God's faithfulness hasn't changed.
That's right.
We've always prayed that our children, just like my friends at school had told me in college about Christ, and that's how I was saved. I always told the kids that, hey, when you guys go off to college, that's what I want you guys to do. There's so many hurting people, hurting students that are there that want to know the Lord. They want to be free from this dark world.
Right.
And you guys are going to be the world changers.
Right.
And at first, you know, I thought, you know, my Selah, is she going to get that chance? And the Lord was so faithful. Yeah. And the people that came to speak about her was so honoring her life. And then I'm sure you will share now the life-transforming work that God has been doing in all of the kids' lives.
So, Bill, briefly, tell us about the graveside service, and then I want you to just share what's going on in the life of a lot
that's
of
important,
kids right
yes.
now.
So I think it'd be best if Jason shared what was going on in his heart about wrestling with making peace about all of this.
Yeah, so I was at peace that God had the final say. I felt like we had done everything that God wanted us to do. I felt at peace about everything except one thing. As a father, I felt like I had this picture of just walking Selah down the aisle one day. Mm. And I'm very visual, so I had that picture in my mind. And I was wrestling with why God gave me that picture if that wasn't going to happen. And I didn't verbalize it. I didn't even verbalize it to God. Like I said, afterwards, I didn't know how to pray, so I didn't even pray that. I didn't ask God about it or question him about that. I didn't tell Smitha about it because I didn't want that to be an additional burden for her. I was literally just grumbling in my heart about that one thing. Mm. And we're going to the graveside. I've been to graveside before, and I've heard messages at the graveside before, and I was expecting.
You didn't share about the veil. Before we close the casket?
Saturday morning before we close the casket in our culture, and I thought this was normal for everybody, but apparently it's something that in our culture that we have a white veil that we place over the face before they close the casket. So we had done that, and Pastor Bill had walked up at just that very moment and seen us do that. And I'll let him share from there.
Yeah, so... So they close the casket, they have the veil on her face, and we all get in the big procession to drive to the cemetery. And I'm with our campus pastor, Steve Daigle, and his wife, Kim. And as we're driving there, I get a text from a student that simply said, you know, Selah's really impacted my life. I want to go get baptized tomorrow. I hear you're doing it at the beach. What time? We're at the beach, all this. So I'm communicating back to her. Yes, I'm texting and driving, but I communicate with her that Pompano Pier, 12 noon, we're going to do baptism. And that's happened several times during the week, and every time I immediately call Jason. We have another one getting baptized, and it's just a celebration that we have for Selah's, what we call now Selah's harvest, this harvest that's coming in. And but I was like, I can't joyfully show up and tell him this is his daughter's graveside, so... So I start realizing I'm getting out of the car right now. I'm far too joyful. That just ruined my whole countenance. You know, I need to have the proper countenance for the occasion. And I certainly did the whole week before. I mean, I was crying my eyes out for a lot of it. And so I started saying, okay, I need to focus in on my message right now. I got to focus in because another part, I think it's Indian culture, right, to give out three verses to pastors or some people to read. So I had those scriptures ready to go. And so I was trying to focus in on the message, but I was still too happy. And so I started saying, "The Lord, take my joy right now, please. Take my joy. Give me I want to serve this family. It's all I wanted to do is serve you guys and serve you well." And so I wanted the compassion and the empathy, but I was, some reason, this girl, because this is a girl that I didn't really anticipate wanting to get baptized, but so I was very joyful. But anyways, so I get there and I'm locked into these three scriptures because I already had to have them written out and I have to pass them out. So I passed them out to the three guys. And so I start focusing in on the message, and one of the funeral directors says, "Hey, we have, how many roses did you have anyway?" So like 80 to 100.
I think 120 or more. Yeah.
So there's about 120 roses that 120 different people have. And they said at some point, invite them up to lay it on the casket. So I'm like, okay, so I got to make sure I don't forget that. And I'm trying to put it all together. And so the first scripture I was going to have read was about death having no victory. So I just kind of ran with that and said, "Guys, I don't want you to be fooled by this casket or this cemetery. Death did not win here. She's awake." And that's where I was going to go with it. But instead of just saying alive and awake, I started saying she's a bride. And then I was thinking of the veil. Yes, and there's a veil. And so then the next pastor read from Romans 8 that not even death can separate us from the love of God that's in Christ Jesus. And so I was just going to, you know, let her know that death, not only does death not have victory, but it's not separating her from this love. But because of the veil, I started thinking, wait, this love is a marriage love. This is a bridegroom-bride love, and that's very biblical. Yeah. You know, this is not just nice talk. This is scripture that should be shown. And so I started saying, hey, not only is this love not going to end, but I said, I do weddings, and I end with till death do you part, but here's a love that there is no death that will do them part. Right. They are forever bride and bridegroom, and right, nothing's going to separate that now. So now I'm into a wedding message and realizing I can't really go back.
Now
you know,
now
so
you're there.
Now I'm there, and I was worried about these guys because I was in my head. I'm going, they're going, how can you be talking about a wedding? This is so. But I was like, I'm here. Here we go. So I walked up to Jason while they're putting the roses down. I said, Jason, go last. Be the last one to lay a rose down. And he said, okay, you know. But then I said, do you think you'd be able to give your daughter away in marriage to Jesus Christ today? And I was ready for the, are you out of your, what are you thinking? What are you doing right now? You know? But I literally was compelled. And I couldn't even think about what I was going to do before. This is the only thing I could think about. So I did my best to talk about Jesus getting a bride, which is the church, is the same way that Adam got a bride in the garden, and I put all that together, and I literally had the feeling of, you're up to your neck in this message right now, and I don't know how it's going to go. And so Jason started tearing up and everything, and half of me wanted to apologize and say, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to throw you that curveball. But he just said, do as you feel led, or something like that. You know, go as you're being led. And so I was like, all right. So Jason stood with the final rose, and then I was so nervous. I don't know if you could tell, but I was so nervous because I knew what I was going to say, and I thought, this is either great or terrible. There's really no in between with this. So I said, so who gives this woman to be married to her Savior? And I asked him to say, her mother and I. And he said it, and then he approached the casket and put the final rose down. Now, I finished with hey, after every wedding, there's a wedding feast. You know, and Revelation ends at a wedding feast, and we had a great banquet waiting for them at the church that people are literally commenting, this looks like a wedding, not a memorial, because there's beautiful flowers and white linens and everything. And then more of the pieces were coming together because I was told that they actually had to switch dresses for her in the casket, and they ended up with a white linen dress. Mm. And the verse from Revelation I had the third pastor read says we're dressed in the white linen of our righteous deeds.
Wow.
So I was like, this is so from God. This is so from God. And then I started getting good feedback, and I was so grateful for that. And started getting very good feedback about it, that a lot of their pastors that are in their family are like, can I use that? You know, and I was like, yeah, you know.
I still got a call today asking about, do you have that recorded?
Yeah, yeah. And but the next day when Jason and I went out to do the first round of baptisms of about 9 students that wanted to get baptized, I think it was there you shared with me. You said what he started with, that that's the only part of this whole thing I really got no peace with. I could not figure out why God would allow me to see that vision. Yeah.
So you had that peace at that time.
Yeah, so the reason I was tearing up is because I was like, God, how did you know? Because like I said, I didn't verbalize it.
Amazing.
Like,
it's actually all of us, I think, saw it at the same time when they put that veil over and didn't communicate, obviously, with each other. But what we saw was a bride in there.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And so even though he didn't say it, I felt the same way that... Yeah. You know, I want to be able to, you know, give my child away. And we've always prayed about her spouse, who the future spouse would be.
We do that with our kids, you know. We for our kids, we prayed for their spouse.
And out loud with them, you know, so that they could see, oh, they might be at this stage, so pray for them.
Right.
She married well.
She married well.
Yes,
she married
Pastor Bill, we're almost out of time, and I wish we had more time, but we are running out of time.
You know, so Jason and I have been hanging out, like we've been best friends since childhood, and literally he spoke at our chapel, a tremendous message. Teachers that were sitting in the back gave him a standing ovation. Then we went into the restaurant, to the grill, and just hung out there for several hours. Yeah. And we ended up in 2 days having 2 students give their life to the Lord just based on being inspired by Selah.
So there's that time that people are just coming to you.
God has everybody's attention in that community right now.
That's just wonderful.
He has their attention. Yeah. And we did 9 baptisms. Then during the week, I had 2 more kids said they want to be baptized. But by the time we did it today, there was 9, including somebody's mom. And I don't think we're close to done yet. So he's going to speak at 9th and 10th grade chapel, which is Salus Chapel, on this Wednesday. And we have a prayer gathering for revival to continue Wednesday morning. Yep.
You know, maybe somebody's listened tonight and they don't know Jesus in their heart. But tonight's the night that they could give their life to Jesus. So, Bill, would you lead them in a prayer right now for them?
Yes. So this story is a good story only because of resurrection, and Jesus is the only one that can resurrect us from the dead. So I'd invite anybody that was moved by this message and maybe got some clarity about God to simply pray this prayer after me and give your life to Christ tonight. Just say, Dear Lord, I believe that you died on the cross for my sins and you rose again on the third day. Forgive me of my sins. Wash me clean. For I've decided tonight to follow you, Jesus. I open my heart and I ask you inside to be my God, to be my Savior, and to be my friend. And I will follow you from this day and forevermore. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. If you prayed that prayer tonight, we're really excited for you because you've just given your life to Jesus and your life is going to change. You probably have some questions. Hey, what should I do next? Go to our church website, calvarypb.com. Lots of resources there. If you're in our area, come see us at church, and we would love to be able to share the love of Jesus with you there. I want to thank you guys for being here tonight. Smitha,
thank you.
Jason, thank you so much. And you're an amazing couple,
yes.
And I agree with you, and I do some marriage counseling also, that I will keep you guys in mind as the example to way husbands and wives should be. Mm-hmm. And you know, you said that you've learned so much from them, and I know you've done a lot of schooling, and you probably have learned more from them than any schooling that either of us have ever
taken.
They
took the lessons out of the textbook and demonstrated.
And everything just all came together.
Amen.
Pastor Bill, I want to thank you for being here tonight. Great job. And we'll be praying for you. I know school's almost over, and we're going to be praying for you guys. And for all those that listen tonight. I'm just so glad that we've been able to hear your story tonight, and I want to thank you for being here. Hey, join us again on Wednesday night. We'll be back here at 7 o'clock for In the Word Live. Until then, have a great week, and God bless you.
This is Spirit FM Radio.
This is Spirit FM.
Music and ministry to guide your day.
This is Spirit FM.
WAFG LP, Pompano Beach.